American Express, Open Forum, Computer World, Technorati, ZDNet, I'll go on, actually I won't, but I'll tell you, and now at Postal Vision 2022.0. When platform possibilities theming concept for Postal Vision 2022.0 was coming together last fall, Gene Del Polito sent me a link to a new book, The Age of the Platform. And Dr. Del Polito's wishy-washy message said, buy it, read it, it's good. If you know Gene, anybody, that sounds like Gene. I did buy it, and I did read it, and it is good, and it goes a long way in helping to explain why we think it is a worthwhile exercise to look at the Postal Service as a platform, and not necessarily as a technological platform, but as a platform for relating to partners to conduct business. So, like when contacting Jeff Jarvis after reading his book, What Would Google Do?, and asking Jeff to come on board, I did the same with Phil this past year, and I'm pleased that we've built up a telephone and email relationship and met last night when he arrived, and I'm pleased to have and introduce Phil Simon to talk about the age of the platform. Phil, here he is.
Hello, can you hear me okay? Good. Okay. Let's do this. How are we with the remote here? Okay. So everyone's talking about platforms these days, and I find it absolutely fascinating. Back in January, I live in Las Vegas, I went to the Consumer Electronics Show, and they're talking about the car as a platform. As John had mentioned, Tim O'Reilly's talking about government as a platform. I read an article on Forbes a couple months ago about the credit card as a platform. So everyone's talking about platforms, but as John had pointed out, there doesn't seem to be a great deal of clarity about platforms and what they mean. Everyone seems to have a different definition. So over the next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to talk a bit about the book that you all have, again, thank you to John, and understand where platforms are going, what they can do. But first, I'd like everybody to get up. I like to start off my talks with a little bit of an experiment. You will not be standing for long, I promise you. Okay. By the way, can we get for the slides the presentation mode? That'd be great. So, have a seat if you use any Amazon products or services. Amazon.com, Kindle, Kindle Fire. Okay, what are you, about 20 people? Next up, Apple. If you're an Apple user, have a seat. Anybody left? Okay, we'll get you. Are you a Facebook user? If you use Facebook, have a seat. We got one. Do you use Google? Wow. Okay. Okay, so we got you. And if you think about it, I just named four companies that virtually everybody uses. And they don't use these companies, products and services, because they have to use them. They use them because they want to use them. And I found that fascinating. And if you go back, say, 15 years ago to the world of enterprise IT, if you looked at the major technologies that people use, the major companies, Microsoft, Oracle, SAP, IBM, you used them because you went to work and you had to use them, not because you wanted to use them. So, about a year ago when I was writing the book, I stumbled upon this quote from Eric Schmidt, who at the time was the CEO of Google. And he had said that, it seems to me there are four companies that are exploiting platform strategies really well. And he said this about a year ago. And those companies are Apple, Amazon, Facebook, and Google. And he called these companies the Gang of Four. And it was interesting because I just published my third book, The New Small. It was about 11 small businesses that were doing really interesting things with technologies. But what four companies had everybody heard of that were doing the same sort of interesting things? And it was obvious to me that if I had to work for a big company, it would be one of these four. And as I studied these companies and did some research and talked to some people, I realized that it wasn't simply about having the best technology. In fact, they had stumbled upon an entirely new business model. And that's what we're going to talk about today, the platform. So what do we mean about platforms? Let's get a definition out here. We've entered, I would argue, the age of the platform. But what is a platform? And one of the most important things I think to do here is to distinguish between technology platforms, if you like, with a little p, and this notion that you we'll see in the book, platform of the big P, platform of the business model. Now, technology platforms with a little P have been around for a very long time, right? John mentioned before the transportation system, right? You could also argue that operating systems are platforms or telephone lines, right? But I'm really talking in the book about the platform with a big P, a really big idea. And by that I mean this fundamentally new business model. And it's not just Amazon, Apple, Facebook, and Google, although those are probably the four most prominent companies. I'm talking about other companies with emerging platforms like Twitter, like WordPress, like Foursquare, like LinkedIn. And also in the book, I profile smaller companies with 10, 20 people that get this notion of a platform. And if you break a platform down, as I do in the book, and I found John's diagram quite interesting, actually, with the different layers, and it's the same kind of concept here. To me, a platform is a set of integrated planks, features, apps, products, or services. And I'm going to share some examples later on. So a company like Netflix, nothing wrong with them, but it's not really a platform, right? Sort of a pet peeve of mine when people misuse the term. How is Netflix a platform? What can I build as a developer on top of Netflix? Netflix is pretty much a single-purpose company, and it's great. There's nothing wrong with it, but it isn't a true platform. And there are a lot of benefits to creating one, okay? Particularly when we get into this notion of ecosystems, right? When you build an ecosystem, you can take your platform in all sorts of different directions. So most of us would agree that Steve Jobs is a pretty smart guy, right? There's just no way, though, that he said back when he launched the App Store that Angry Birds will be created and downloaded 250 or whatever it is million times, right? It's just not possible. So in a way, you're externalizing the innovation. You're getting people to take your platform in different directions. And later on, I'm going to talk a little bit more about some of those examples. So the ecosystems make the platforms that much more powerful. Okay, you can't predict the future. You don't know what's going to be successful, but you're mitigating your risk. You're putting these tools out there. You're letting people put apps in the App Store, the Android Store, and then the public votes, and something can become viral like Instagram and get bought for, say, $1 billion. There's no way that you could have predicted that. So when I talk in the book about platforms, you very much have to understand the uncertainty involved. If you're looking for a 5-year plan and a 10-point checklist, or you can keep looking, right? I really don't believe that you can map things out, right? Who predicted exactly the Arab Spring? Things happen today quicker than ever, and that trend is not going to stop anytime soon. So I want to focus for a little bit about Google and how Google became a true platform. Now in 1998, and I was around, search was terrible. Alta Vista, Lycos, right? You didn't really have the ability to find things the way we can today. And Google came along and it completely disrupted search. I just finished reading John Battelle's book, The Search, and it was fascinating because search, again, back then was a complete mess, and today it's much, much better. But Google, even though it was making billions from AdSense and AdWords, understood that it wasn't a platform yet. It was an amazing and profitable search engine. But in order to stay around for the future, right, search can be disrupted. John mentioned before Polaroid. You can also take a look at companies like Kodak. Think about the companies that at one point were the best in the class, right? Companies that seemed like they could do no wrong. Well, a lot of those companies aren't around anymore. I read a statistic something about 2 years ago that of the initial 100 companies founded on the New York Stock Exchange, only 9 are around, right? So odds are businesses have sort of a life cycle, and after hitting their peak, they may go down and not come back. Google didn't want to do that. So why would Google change, right? Why become a platform? You are the best search engine, right? You went public, your stock is trading at all-time high, you have all these millionaires and billionaires at the company. Why become a platform? Okay. Well, quite honestly, in the age of the platform, if you're only a single-purpose company, you run an incredible risk of being disintermediated. And Larry and Sergey and Eric Schmidt understood this very, very well. There's a book by Clayton Christensen called The Innovator's Dilemma. And it goes through how companies become successful because they disintermediate or they disrupt, but because of that, they hang on to those technologies and that forces them to miss important trends, okay? So if you think, as I said before, about Kodak or Polaroid, I read a statistic a couple of months ago that I think it was Kodak invented digital film in 1975. And it was something like 6 months ago that Kodak officially declared bankruptcy, and now there's a patent fight with Apple. But for the most part, Kodak is irrelevant and has been for a long time. So how do you go from completely dominant to completely irrelevant? Well, there's no secret sauce, but the guys at Google understood this. So Google is very much committed to innovation and change and disrupting itself. There's a great quote in the Steve Jobs book by Isaacson from the man himself. And Jobs said, your business is going to be cannibalized. The only question is, who's going to do it, you or your competition? At Google, this is very much a part of their DNA. So we know why Google wanted to become a platform. The question is how. And Google added Gmail and Maps and Docs and Plus, Blogger, YouTube, Android, all of these different planks to fill out its platform. In fact, you could argue that it went too far. Right before his death, Steve Jobs was talking to Larry Page, who had taken over as CEO of Google, and said, you guys are all over the place. You do too many different things. So it's not like you can do one thing and you can't do everything, but there is a happy medium. So Google, if you look at its history, yes, has invented things, and some of those things haven't been terribly successful. You can make the argument that Google Buzz and Wave and Orkut, its social planks, didn't go very well, and now Google seems to be doing a lot better with Google Plus. So sometimes it's invented, sometimes it's acquired. Google bought Android, which was an Israeli company, I believe in 2008. Google bought YouTube for $1.65 billion in 2007. And some people said, you guys are crazy. Well, if you pay attention to what Google's doing with YouTube now, it's become an incredibly effective plank in its platform. And Google isn't alone. I could easily run through the gamut here, but I'll just talk for a little bit about Amazon. In 1994, when Jeff Bezos quit his job as a hedge fund manager to start the company, he said, I want to be the world's biggest bookstore. And he succeeded. Well, if you look at what Amazon is right now, it sells hardware with Kindle and Kindle Fire. It's become a publisher. It sells a hell of a lot more on the site than books. And actually, this is very interesting. Last year, it made about $850 million from selling excess compute power through Amazon Elastic Cloud. Now, again, Jeff Bezos is this incredibly smart guy, but you can't tell me in 1995, when he started the company, they said, yeah, we'll probably make about $1 billion from selling excess compute power, right? You can't. But because Amazon's data centers are so powerful, they generate extra capacity, right, in the age of the platform. You need scale. You need the ability to grow as quickly as possible. You never know when something is going to go viral. Well, why let that vaporize, okay? So these are just two examples of companies that have embraced this platform-type thinking. And these, as I said before, there's no checklist for building a platform. But when I looked at these companies and some of the other ones, I did notice that they have a decent number of things in common. First up, they frequently add planks to their platforms. Okay, we mentioned Google with Google Plus. Apple, in 2007, formally dropped computer from its legal name. It was founded in, I believe, was it 78, 79, as Apple Computer. Well, by 2007, Apple was no longer a computer company. Now, you can argue that this was just good marketing, right? And Steve Jobs knew something about marketing, right? So Apple is a lot cleaner than Apple Computer, right? Facebook used to be the Facebook. They dropped the. But really, if you think about Apple, it isn't just a computer company. In fact, if you look at Apple's financials, it makes a very low percentage of its overall revenue from selling proper computers, right? It's making a killing with iPhone. It doesn't make as much from iPod as it used to. iPad's making a lot of money. I'm sure Apple TV will wind up being successful. So they're adding planks to their platforms. They're not just doing one thing, okay? And sometimes that means failure, right? With Google, again, Google Plus is the fourth bite at the apple with social technologies. So they frequently add these planks to their platforms. This is critical here, and it's particularly apropos for the Postal Service because there are alternatives. Maybe 50, 100, 200 years ago, there weren't as many options to send things. Well, now, forget digital and the fact that fewer things need to be actually sent, there is a lot of competition. These are much more consumer-oriented than business-oriented. When I had everybody stand up, and I can't believe we had to get to Google. That was the first time that happened. In fact, last time I was in DC, I spoke at an event with about 200 people as well. And one guy was standing at the end, and the moderator said, I have one question for the guy standing. Which cave do you live in? So these are consumer-oriented technologies. No one uses Amazon, Apple, Facebook, and Google because they have to. When there was this hubbub about Google's privacy policy, people said, well, I don't like this because I don't have the option to opt out. Oh, really? Is Google the only search engine, right? If you want to watch videos, do you have to use YouTube? Absolutely not. For the most part, people use these products because they want to use these products. So these companies don't take anything for granted. These are not complacent organizations, right? All of these companies understand the innovator's dilemma. All these companies realize that they may be dominant now, but in 5 years, they might not be the case. Inside Google, they are paranoid about Facebook. And yet, Facebook's had some problems lately with the stock going public and not doing terribly well, but they are scared. Why? Google owns 68% of the US search market. They're clearly dominant. They're making money hand over fist. So why are they scared, right? Why not sit back and relax? Well, think about the nature of search. Think about, well, I could Google best restaurants. I can go to Yelp or Angie's List or something like that. Or I can ask my friends. And I trust my friends maybe than I trust an algorithm more. Okay? So these are more consumer-oriented technologies. You're not compelled to use any of them. Most important, arguably, these companies are rooted in emerging technologies. I'm talking about cloud computing. I'm talking about mobility. With the exception of Apple, which was founded in the late 70s, Facebook, Amazon, Google all came about in the age of the internet. So these companies understand the importance of emerging technologies. Now, it's important to note that just because a company has powerful technologies doesn't mean that it's going to continue to be successful, right? If I wrote this book, say, 10 years ago, it wouldn't be called The Age of the Platform, but if we're focusing on the Gang of Four, well, it would have been Apple, Amazon, Facebook, and Google, right? Apple was just coming out with the iPod then. It wasn't nearly as dominant as today. Facebook didn't exist. Amazon had some problems with stock. 10 years ago, we were talking about AOL, we're talking about MySpace, we're talking about Yahoo and Microsoft. Now, Microsoft's still around, but those other three companies are, for the most part, irrelevant. So having emerging technologies doesn't guarantee anything. This is much more of a cultural mindset. It's much more about management. It's not, okay, well, we've got the cloud, therefore we're fine. It's really not about that at all. But there's one more thing to pay tribute to the late Steve Jobs. These companies had iconic leaders. They were not democracies. And to me, this is a fundamental challenge for the Postal Service, right? You can't necessarily have one person dictating. You're talking about different levels of government. You're talking about, what do we say, 8 or 9 million employees. That's a lot to manage. If you look inside these companies, they are not democracies, right? Jeff Bezos has wrangled more than a few people. If you read the Isaacson book on Steve Jobs, you realize just how difficult that guy could be. Now, he was normally right, but you can't necessarily dictate in a government entity the same way you can at a company like Facebook, okay? So these people don't think necessarily about, well, I gotta hit my quarterly results. Jeff Bezos has consistently irritated investors because he has said, he's gone on record saying making a profit is the stupidest thing we can do. Well, if you own Amazon stock, you don't really want to hear that, right? But he understood the nature of platforms and the need to get big fast. Now, even though these platforms have a great deal in common, there are actually some commonalities here. There is no one right way, okay? I can talk to you for a long time about how Amazon, early on, had a mantra of getting as big as possible, as fast as possible. Jeff Bezos understood the importance of something called first mover advantage, right? Now, if you look at Facebook, by contrast, Facebook was not the first social network. Classmates.com, MySpace, Friendster. Zuckerberg, to his credit, at the age of 20 or 21, a great book by David Kirkpatrick called The Facebook Effect. It's a lot better than the movie The Social Network. But he gets into the mindset of Mark Zuckerberg. And he understood that, show of hands, anyone ever used Friendster back in the day? Okay, a couple hands. The concept behind Friendster was fantastic. It was basically Facebook with less functionality, but I could connect with my friends. This was before the social web. But if you remember Friendster, and granted not everyone had broadband back then, it was very difficult to use because pages would take 3 or 4 minutes to load. And Mark Zuckerberg understood that back in 2005, 2006, when remember Facebook was only for people with an EDU domain for their email, right? Only for schools and certain schools at that. He understood that if it didn't live up to the hype, then people would go, what was the big deal? This sucks, I don't want to use it anymore. So he intentionally didn't scale as quickly as possible. There were schools clamoring for it. He said, I want you to have Facebook, but I want it to be everything that you heard it could be and more. So there isn't, as I said before, a checklist. I can also look at, say, the Apple store versus, say, Android. Android's the wild, wild west. There are many different versions of Android. That's much more open, right? And some people would say chaotic. If you take a look at what Apple does with the App Store, it's much more controlled. Now, you can get an app in the App Store, I know from personal experience because I have one for my last book, but there is a process, okay? It isn't totally open. So there is no one right way, okay? However, scale, experimentation, and speed are critical. And not just now, but in the future. And there's a great story that I read about when I was researching the book on Twitter. And Twitter, around 2009, started having some growing pains because it was becoming very popular. And Twitter, not to bore everyone, was initially conceived on this Ruby on Rails framework. It's basically a free open source back end that would support Twitter. But it wasn't meant to handle 30, 40, 50 million tweets a day. So over the course of 3 to 4 months, the guys at Twitter said, if we continue to grow, we're going to have major problems, right? And you still see them these days, right? When you have 650 tweets a second for something trending, you might see the whale. It still happens from time to time, but it's a lot less frequent. The guys at Twitter took out Ruby on Rails and they brought in Scala, which is a much more powerful data management system. Okay, so it's not simply about managing the growth now, it's about being able to manage growth when you don't expect it. Okay. It's essential to add these new and popular planks. You don't want to be standing still. Now, certainly companies can overreach, and in the book I certainly bring out examples of companies that have done this type of thing. But again, assuming that tomorrow will be the same as today is fundamentally wrong. This is why Google spends so much time and money on Plus. Social is important. In fact, true story, inside Google, the bonuses of, I believe, every employee are based on success in social media. That's how seriously the company takes social, because it realizes that Google could go the way of AOL or MySpace or Yahoo. Next up, the Gang of Four consistently cross-pollinates, and by that I mean that Amazon has an official YouTube channel or Google has an official Twitter feed. So these companies aren't necessarily about inventing the wheel. Yes, Apple is more social, but it's not going to compete with Facebook anytime soon. Right? If you look at, say, iTunes and you've got the ping functionality, they're getting you to like, if you like, a particular band and you can connect with other fans, but Apple isn't really going to launch a social network. So they're taking advantage, or if you look at an Amazon product page, you'll see the like button, you will see the retweet button. Okay, so they're consistently looking at other platforms, and they're using those platforms as planks in their own. Now, as I said before, platforms aren't entirely new, but there's been this fundamental shift based on a lot of the technology and based on these more open ecosystems. In the 1990s, when I was working mostly in enterprise IT, okay, I guess this doesn't support the movie. There was a graphic here that shows that you had two or three different sort of partners connected to kind of a platform. But in the diagram on the right, in the age of the platform, you've got many more different connections. It looks a lot more involved. So not a big deal there. The whole point of an ecosystem, as I said before, is to promote external innovation. You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know what's going to go viral. You don't know what's going to be popular. Okay. And the more powerful platforms these days have these incredibly vibrant ecosystems. So I'm talking about partners, developers, users, customers, communities, people who can take your platform in totally different directions, right? Because I don't believe anybody can predict the future. And there's a great story from, I believe it was 2010. Most people here have heard of Twitter, right? And if you look at just basic Twitter 2 years ago, it was one stream of information that quite honestly was very difficult to manage, right? And there are tools now called Hootsuite and TweetDeck that actually let you create your own sort of sub-beats, right? So I'm a big tennis fan, right? It was just the French Open, so I'll have a feed for what's going on in Roland Garros, or a feed for my friends, or a feed for different thought leaders, or different hashtags, right? One of them was called TweetDeck, and Twitter looked at TweetDeck and said, this is really useful, and they bought the company for $40 to $50 million. Again, the ecosystem developed the tool, and Twitter said, we want that tool, we're gonna buy it. I could talk for a long time about Twitter because a lot of the core features of Twitter actually were not invented by the guys from Twitter. The retweet button wasn't their idea. Someone said, hey, can I just easily retweet this? Yeah, that's a great idea, right? Or the hashtag, right? Again, that did not come from the guys at Twitter. So I'm talking about an ecosystem in which the innovation is largely external. Okay. But anyone can say, right, if you look at the troubles that Research in Motion is having right now, we want an ecosystem, we want to have people develop for it. Well, they have to have sufficient incentives. I don't believe that anyone's going to develop for your platform just because it's an honor to do it, right? They need to have some sort of skin in the game. So when I spend the time and money developing an app, and the app sells for a dollar, then Apple takes a 30% cut, and then I get the other 70%, okay? If that 70-30 split is actually quite common, if you look at, say, Google's take with AdSense or with Facebook and credits, right? So if you buy virtual goods for Cityville or Farmville or Mafia Wars, Facebook's going to take 30%, the other 70% go to Zynga. You want to incentivize your community. Okay? But incentives aren't enough, right? They have to have the tools. And here I'm talking about application programming interfaces and software development kits. APIs essentially connect devices to each other, right? Or you could say bring in a Twitter feed. So one of my favorite APIs is based off of Google Maps, and there's an application that I have for the iPhone called FlightAware. So because that app was built off the Google Maps API, I can track where a flight is on Earth. That's just one example here. And then when you get into software development kits, people can actually build the apps and take them in these really interesting directions. I was watching a TED video about 6 months ago. It's a 12-year-old kid who submitted two apps. His parents paid the $100 for the license. And he says, in the future, I just want to build more apps. Now, who knows what a 12-year-old can do, right? But he's starting at an early age. Who knows in 10 years what kind of apps people like this will wind up creating? It's arrogant isn't the right word, but it's very presumptuous to say, well, we know everything that our customers would want. And if you look at these funding platforms out there, has anyone ever heard of Kickstarter? It's absolutely fantastic. If you haven't checked it out, check it out. It was recently, I write for Inc. Magazine, and I did a piece recently on funding platforms. And there's a company called Pebble Watch that wanted to raise $100,000 to build a watch with apps. So $100,000, right, decent amount of money. Guess how much they raised? Anyone know? $10 million. They had to cut them off. They said, all right, we'll stop selling them right now because we're not sure how we're going to make all these things. So if anyone would have predicted that, why would they even have gone to Kickstarter, right? So you don't know. And it's that sense of uncertainty in the age of the platform that makes a lot of people uncomfortable. A few more examples here of ecosystems in action, because to me, this is absolutely fascinating. The man here is Jordan Rudess. He's the keyboardist for one of my favorite bands, Dream Theater. He went to this Juilliard School of Music when he was 9 years old. I often joke that if you gave this guy a soda can, he would turn it into an instrument, play it, record it with his iPhone, and be up on YouTube. Unbelievably talented musician and actually a nice guy. I met him a bunch of times. He, aside from playing piano and all these different instruments, actually is very interested in electronic music. And he formed a company called Wisdom Music. And Wisdom Music creates apps. And you see him playing one on stage on his iPad. And the sounds that come out of this, watch his video sometimes. It's absolutely hysterical. But he just keeps coming up with stuff. So when he's playing at a Dream Theater concert to 5 or 10,000 people, a lot of Dream Theater fans are musicians. So they have their iPhone or they have their iPad and they go, oh, what's the app called? They Google it, they find it, they buy the app right then and there. So in a sense, he's not only making money for himself, remember the 70-30 split, he's also making money for Apple. Ecosystems in action, okay? That's the kind of marketing that's really tough to get anywhere else. Next up, this is Amanda Hawking. And she's a 26 or 27-year-old writer of sort of teen vampire fiction. And she actually was in the news recently because she had made, I want to say, $1 million selling self-published books through Amazon Kindle Direct. And she became such a rock star that when she said, hey, I'm open to possibly working with a big publisher, most writers have a hard time attracting the interest of publishers. Amanda Hawking was in a bidding war and ultimately signed a 4-year, $2 million deal with, I believe it was St. Martin's Press. So no one could possibly have predicted that, because if you're a publisher, why wouldn't you have just thrown her $50,000, right? Again, no one could have predicted it. And then finally, you might know him, if not directly, but because you see a lot of the feeds from his company's products in Facebook. This is Mark Pincus of Zynga. And his company, Zynga, is building apps on top of the Facebook platform. So in the book, I talk about frenemies and co-opetition. He's driving a lot of money to Facebook, but Facebook's also driving a lot of money to him. So it's almost like mutually assured destruction, right? To his credit, Pincus understands that just being on the Facebook platform is actually quite dangerous. And as a result, he's been looking at ways to get on, say, Google or Twitter, because Twitter is going to be developing apps as well. So again, these ecosystems are taking platforms in completely different directions. And I want to close here by talking about some implications for the Postal Service. And I've seen some of the articles on LinkedIn, some of the blog posts about fixing the Postal Service. It's an interesting concept, but I reject the notion that something is fixed and is permanent. We're not talking about breaking your arm and putting it in a cast for 2 months and then your arm is fine. You're constantly going to have to evolve here. I don't believe that there's necessarily one quick fix. What works now may not work in 2 or 3 years. if you look at Google 5 years ago, it's not the same as Google today. And I don't believe it'll be the same as Google in 5 years. So it's a continuous evolution. Also, again, it's about culture more than about technology. Are you willing to put the future of the business to some extent in the hands of other people? Again, I don't believe there's a five-year roadmap. I don't believe there's this big checklist. Are you willing to work with potential competitors? Are you willing to explore partnerships? I believe that it's imperative these days. There isn't necessarily this recipe for success, but I think that recognition of that is the first start. So I think we're up for the panel. Thank you.